How's it going?
Sorry, I was muted that whole time, wasn't I? I said, good, how are you doing?
Oh my gosh, that's okay. I was like, he must be doing something.
Yeah, I am doing a bunch of things, but I
No.
thought I was talking to you.
So funny. Yeah, I'm good, thanks. How are you doing?
Doing well.
Did you see how many people were down there? How many chairs they got?
Andrea, I'll text down to the clubhouse and see if they can get on the call.
Sounds good.
They're there.
Jim, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You hear us?
Yes.
We hear you.
All right. Good. So I just want to, just test this. Is this a, how do I sound to you guys right now?
I can hear you with background music.
Okay. All right, so that's the music. I'm going to put this music back on a little bit later. Okay, but you can hear us, see us. Let me put this down
here.
That's good. I think we're in good shape.
Looking good, sounding good.
Looks good. Sounds good down here.
Yeah, everything sounds great down here.
Well, here comes the video.
Passion, dedication, sacrifice, triumph. These are the shared stories of U.S. speed skating legends. Eric Heiden.
Eric Heiden has the lead as he crosses the finish line.
Bonnie Blair.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I think we're good there.
That transition looked really good too, I thought.
Yeah, from Brakes, the Brakes logo to the roll. It's yeah. Perfect. So, Andrea, are you there?
Yes, I am.
So what I'll do is I'll call you. 7 o'clock is when we're looking to do this, right?
Yes.
So at 7, actually 6:50 is when the guests are coming from the other room to hear.
Okay.
It'll probably take 10 minutes to get everybody in here. At 7 o'clock, I'll call you. Once everybody's in here, I'll just call you and let you know that, hey, all of Mike's guests on this end are in the room.
Sounds good.
And it'll just be a matter of then Matt listening into the Zoom call with Ted, and then rolling that video when Ted calls for it. And then when you roll the video, Matt, you'll just have to leave. You'll have to go from the Braves logo to the Zoom call video, right?
Yeah. So do we want to see Ted on the TV sound there while he's doing the introduction?
No.
I mean, he's introducing the moderator and giving a small background on him, so it might be nice. I know his camera will be on, so.
Well, if that's the case, then we're not using the video then as that attention grabber to the room, right? You're going to have about 40 people in here just kind of, kind of looking around and talking and, I mean, we could start it with Ted if you want, and we can just get everybody seated and paying attention before the program begins.
I think that would work best. Yeah.
Okay. All right, so that's what we'll do then. So as soon as they get in here then, I'll just ask Mike, hey, everybody, just take a seat. We'll begin. Mm-hmm. And as people are taking a seat, I'll just be on the phone with you, and I'll say, hey, we're ready to go.
Yep, and then I'll let Ted know, and then he'll –
and so whenever you guys begin, then Matt will just take us from the Braves logo to the Zoom call.
Mm-hmm. Well, I won't. Yeah, Ted's gonna be talking. Like if I'm Ted, I'm talking, and then I throw it to the video. I'm just gonna go to the video full screen like that, and then press play.
Yeah,
and then I'd go back to speaker.
Yeah, so you're going to go from logo. Now you're going to go from logo to speaker view.
Right.
To video to speaker view.
Yep.
And then I'm going to keep the music on here, and I'll turn the music. Once we tell everybody to sit down, I'll turn the music off, and then I'll call you, and I'll let you know, Andrea, now that they're ready to go here.
Mm-hmm.
It just might not be directly at 7 o'clock, but we'll see. It's 6:50, Mike is bringing him over here.
Okay. Great.
And during the call, of course, I'm going to have my video off, and I'll mute myself too.
Okay. Great. Okay.
So what is it? What does the Zoom call look like then? Oh no, we're seeing it. We're seeing it. So you're gonna, Andrea, you're gonna mute us. After we're done with all this, you're gonna mute us, right?
After we're done with the testing now. Probably once Eddie and Lee join, just until they get kind of set, and then if we still have some technical things to work on at that point, we can. But I think we just want to make sure they're all set first.
Okay, but we're going to do that prior to the guests coming into this room, right?
Yes.
Okay. So what time are they expected to join us? At the 30?
I believe so. I can confirm with Ted.
Music back on. Music back on. Just rain, there ain't no need to go outside. But just made it like a old lady. Mama made a baby. Really don't mind the practice, cause you're my little baby. Lady made it up, cause I love to lay your legs. Close the curtains, pretend like there's no world outside. We're pretending all the time. Can't you see that it's just raining? There ain't no need to go outside.
All right, buddy, thanks.
So I just talked with Ted. So I guess they're now coming on at 4:45, 6:45 your time. There was a little delay on their end. So we were just wondering if it's possible to mute the sound and video while Lee and Eddie are getting set, and then you guys can still come on like at like 5 of or something like that. I don't know if that's something Matt could control.
Yeah. Yeah, Matt, are you there?
Yeah, I can't control the room down there. Andrew, you should be able to mute Scott Cunningham.
The question is we're going to need to mute. We should be able to hear the call here in the room. Matt's got us where we're looking at the Braves logo, which is fine. But if we're doing tests at 6:50 and people are coming in, they're going to hear the test going on. So I'm wondering how we can mute the call. so we don't have to. I wonder if that's me.
Yeah, you just mute your Zoom, Scott.
I mute my Zoom? No, but then I'm going to hear.
Yeah, they'll still hear our conversation, even if the call, even if they.
You have to hang up the call.
Yeah, I don't want to do that.
I get that.
You know, I can do is I can delay them coming in until we're done with our pre-check at 6:45.
Okay.
That way, it just might be a little convenient. I can just say, hey, listen. Mike, let's not. Well, how long do you think it's going to check? How much time do they need to do the check on their end?
Just ask for 10 minutes.
So 6:45 to 6:55. So maybe I just say 6:55, we'll start walking them over here instead of 6:55.
That's good.
Well, that's going to be close.
No.
Okay. Well, it is what it is. I'll just tell Mike to hold on for another 5 minutes. Is that cool?
Sorry about that last minute change.
That's all right. So I'll just ask Mike to hold his crew for another 5 minutes and start walking over here at 6:55. Or you know what I'll do? I'll just say, look, man, let me call you. I'll call him.
I want you. Watch you fly.
And I'll let him know when we're ready.
Nothing to do. Oh, just thinking that you're back.
All right, I'm gonna walk out of here for just a minute, okay? I'm gonna go talk to Mike. So just
I'm gonna step away from my computer also, just for about 5 minutes. If you need anything, just text me.
Sounds okay. Good.
Send your text me too, okay? Thank you.
It's up with the stars. Maybe it's under the sea. Maybe it's not very far. Maybe this is how it's supposed to be. Maybe this is how it's supposed to be. Maybe it's trapped in a jar. Hold you in my own two hands.
Hey guys, anyone there?
Hi, Eddie.
Hi. You ready to freak out? How you doing, Mauro?
Good. Oh, nice hairdo.
Thank you. Thank you. It's we're trying something different.
Cheers.
Cheers. How's everything been?
Good. Hey, congrats to the baby. Looks damn cute.
Thank you. It's not because of me. It's more because of Gabby. It's a spitting image of Gabby.
Doesn't matter. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you so much. How's life been? Good?
Yeah, I can't complain. You know, the COVID summer for me is like a lot of outdoor activity with not a whole lot of people out there.
Okay, that's fantastic. Oh, Laura, a little bit.
Hey, Dave. And your background looks like all like adult living, man.
Yeah, no, I'm at a different event right now, actually.
Oh.
Yeah, I had to double dip by mistake. Not planned, I promise. Where are you at, Eddie? Hey, how's it going?
Good, man. How are you?
Good, real good. I'm at a friend's house that I organized a dinner for. One of my best friends is a chef, and he just moved back from Spain. He was supposed to go to Dubai and open up a restaurant.
Yeah.
And I had set up a dinner for him to basically show off his skills.
That's cool.
And yeah, so hopefully. He has 11 courses planned, feeding 10 people. So
what?
we're at a future potential investor.
Yeah.
We'll see. We'll see. How you been?
Ah, man. Good. Very good. I remember seeing you skate when you first came up to the Pettit with your dad. That was a long time ago, man.
Yeah. Wow, that must have been 2002.
Yeah, I think you were working with Whitty a little bit, right?
Yeah, I was around 12 years old. Time flies.
I think he's your biggest fan. I really do. I think Mike's your biggest fan.
Mike, I love that family so much. That family has been nothing but spectacular to me. When I went to Fan Fest in Chicago, they were there.
Yeah.
Yeah, they made it a point.
That's cool.
Awesome.
That's awesome, man.
How's everything on your side?
We're good. You know, I live in Milwaukee. You know, I've been up here for like 30 years now, and I got three kids and great wife who is also a speed skater. She was on national team long track, and she's put up with me for way too long. And
you're a great guy though.
Nah, well,
that's not hard. That can't be hard.
Yeah.
Can't be hard
it's
to
good.
Deal with you. Good. Yeah. That's awesome.
So where are you? Are you in, Miami?
I'm in Miami. Yeah. In Miami right now. So, just taking this time, whatever time we need to do here.
Yeah.
They're taken care of in the kitchen, so we're good.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool. Does he have like a specialty in terms of cuisine, or is he?
He does everything. Yeah. He's very up and coming. He's I couldn't even tell you the chefs he's worked under as sous chef. He moved to New York. Started working under a bunch of well-known chefs, and then he got hired by this company that sent him to Spain. In Madrid, he opened 4 restaurants.
Jesus, man.
And, you know, was the head chef in all of them. And they were going to send – that company was going to send him to Dubai, but he basically got a promotion. So now he's designing and creating the menus for the – new company that he is now working under. So he wants to buy his own space now.
Nice.
So it's hospitality. Why not?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, before you know it. What's his name?
His name is Francisco Troncoso.
Oh, I'm not even going to try it.
Try that, Troncoso. Yeah. So. But to me, he's Pancho. He's a very, very common nickname for that name of the Latin culture.
He'll have a have his own show, Beat Poncho.
I'm sure.
Beat Bobby Flay.
Beat Bobby Flay. Very true. Yeah, that's awesome. Well,
how's it going, Marion? What do you got there?
Pretty good.
What is that? I can't tell, man. It's like a yard sale. Oh, that wait, I didn't give them permission to use my likeness on the can. It's crazy. It's me out.
And how you ski?
Yeah, basically on my ass.
That's awesome.
Oh boy,
is this starting at 7? Just out of curiosity.
Yeah, I think that's when it's. I don't know. What's the bus driver say? What are we doing? Letting a few folks at 7 or?
Yeah, I think so. If you notice the.
Oh, hey, Andrea.
Hey, Eddie. How's it going?
How you doing? You just popped up on my screen there.
Oh, you must have on speaker view. That's why.
Oh, there. Okay. Why? There's a thing.
If
I can
you do gallery
here.
View, you can see all the squares.
Okay, hold up here.
Thanks, Eddie. You make me feel young again.
You're welcome.
But yeah, so if you, the S Bray or the S Cunningham, that's the room with the fisheye lens. And so they're going to start coming in around, let's see, 6:55 or 4:55, depending on where you are.
There he is.
Yeah. Looks like Ted's on. Awesome.
We got the conductor. Driving that train.
Oh, there
driving
is.
That train.
Get Eddie.
Yay. You didn't expect this, huh?
No, I didn't. I didn't look for a blonde. Yeah.
That's what happened. Well, my mother always says she wanted a blonde baby, so I had to, you know, had to help her out on that one. How you been?
Been good. How about you?
Good. Real good. Real good. We're here. We're all here catching up.
Psyched to hear about your new general manager.
Same. I'm actually, she was, when she was with the Dodgers, she worked with my brother.
What? Really?
So yeah, so I'm excited to bring that up to her. Hopefully he didn't do anything that would cost my job, but let's hope not.
So wait, your brother's in baseball?
He used to. He played 7 years with the Dodgers. Triple A. Yeah, he played up to Triple A. A lot of injuries kept him from that true opportunity. Well, needless to say, the 1 year that he was expected to go up, he tore his hamstring completely, and they called up Andre Ethier at the time.
Oh,
instead of him, right?
Oh God,
so. And he was good, man. He was like top 100. He was like top 100 prospect for a few years. He was big boy, 6'3", 230-ish at the time. Wow. I don't know what happened to me. Thankfully, I didn't get my size because it kept me in a skin suit.
Exactly. We'll take it.
Yeah.
Worked out for man. Us.
Worked out. Worked out now? Well. Where am I now?
No, where is he now? What's he doing now? Your brother.
Oh, he's living here. He's starting to get into the construction business with my father a little bit, but he has me and him went in on a business training facility down here in Miami for sports performance facility.
Yeah.
So he's been running that and it's been blowing up. I mean, yeah. Nuts. We got lucky with a team that we were able to put together, man. It's pretty fun. It's fun to see, not really be a part of. Just train there. That's it.
Right. Yeah, I remember that you were telling Hayden about that last year at 88 and counting because
his son
and my son, they're on the same team.
That's
they
right.
Play high
that's
school.
Right.
And so he's like, "Yeah, we should send our boys down there this winter."
I've been. Oh, let me fix this real quick. I've been waiting for that. What happened?
Do you offer scholarships?
Well, no, but I offer a room to sleep in.
That's a scholarship.
Training. Yeah, that's kind of a scholarship, I guess, yeah. It's like aid. It's like more like financial aid than scholarship. That's awesome.
And yeah, is it still going well with the COVID and everything? You're able to get kids in there?
Yeah, for the most part, everyone's got to mask up until they're doing some strenuous activities. All the coaches are masked up. We have temperature checks at the door. It's been good now. We haven't had any scares with the recent spikes in Florida. So, for now, we're just surviving.
Yeah.
Hit us hard a little bit.
I bet.
Yeah. So, how's the training going over there with all this going on?
It's so far so good, you know. We've kept everybody safe. We we've been doing some short track mock races for a couple weeks.
And long track too, right?
Yeah, long track too. And the long track, obviously the times have been super impressive. You know, Aaron Jackson laid down a really fast 500 and
it's like a 37 something, right? 37.4.
Yeah.
Wow. There it goes. Brittany got second, right? I've been trying to keep up a little bit.
Good.
That's incredible. Yeah. Incredible.
But on the short track side, Santos unofficially set world records in the 1,000 and the 1,500. Did she go 2:12 in the 15? Like, or 2:13?
I don't even know what the time was. I think it was 2 seconds under world record.
But yeah, that was 2:12.
With the guys together.
Right.
Like pulled.
Still pretty amazing.
That's incredible. That is incredible. Yeah, she's – well, I saw her last year, and the ladder that she's climbed from Olympic trials, 4 years ago basically to now where I saw her last year, I mean, it was incredible.
Yeah.
She was like one of the ones that like opened my eyes. I was like, geez, she's a fighter too.
Totally. Yeah.
I like that.
It's amazing how far she's come in, 4 or 5 years, right? Incredible amount of progress. So that's the room over there, huh? That we're looking in? That's the clubhouse?
Yeah, so it seems like 95 world champions.
I just want to let you guys know that the visiting club, the visiting side doesn't look so much in that stadium. I was
have to tell them that.
I will. I can't wait. I've been dying to say something about it. I was stuck. They stuck me in the clubby's office because everything was spread out. So they stuck me in the clubby's office. So I can't wait to bring that up. And I'm staring. I mean, I can't even like lean back on my chair because I'm just looking into the showers.
That's funny.
It was something else, but it was funny. Yep. Man.
Even still, though, I mean, what's the difference between AAA and getting up to the bigs, man? That's got to be just dudes. I mean, like, at what point did you stop carrying your bags? That's what I want to know.
Well, okay. Well, hold up here. Technically, the rookies get picked on a lot in the bigs.
Yeah.
So I actually had to carry a lot of the bags from the veteran guys. Yeah, they make the rookies carry bags. They make the rookies get like alcohol for like this year. We had a train ride from New York, from Buffalo to New York or something like that. We had a train ride. They make rookies take a certain amount of beers and, you know, they'll buy the alcohol, but it was our job to bring the bottle onto our flight or train and stuff. And we were the ones serving it because we didn't have any service. So it was awesome, obviously. It's a fucking amazing, excuse my language.
It was really
unbelievable. And but I think I had to carry more in the big leagues, my bags, than I did in AAA. it was so different, to be honest. Yeah. Things are so different during the COVID. It was couldn't leave our rooms. We couldn't leave the vicinity of the hotel. Like, we had to basically go from our room to the bus to the stadium to the bus to the room. And that's it. So, and the Marlins being on all the tabloids, headline news,
Yeah.
We had it. We had our target on our backs. Yeah. It's
not easy, but you did it, man. That's like, holy cow. Man. Like, come on, man. Like, you made it to the bigs. That's just like insane. I was born Ted, Andrea, and Marin with a story earlier. So I worked for the Brewers all in like 10 years, right? I worked on their sponsorship team.
Okay.
And, I had a recurring nightmare, like, and keep in mind, I didn't play ball. I mean, I played like 2 seasons of baseball, right, as a kid, right. And, you know, wasn't great. And, but I knew how to swing a bat and I knew how to catch and throw and stuff, but I had this recurring nightmare. And, I would be all of a sudden I found myself in the Brewers dugout and I'm wearing a Brewers uniform and like either counsel or whoever the manager was at the time, they're like, Tambo, you're up. And I was like, oh shoot, man. And it wasn't like me, like with all of your like experience, it was me as Dave Tamburino, the guy that like, you know, pushes the lawnmower and knows how to speed skate a little bit. No. And I'm like sitting there and I'm walking up and I'm on the on deck circle and I'm like, what the hell am I doing? It was terrifying. It was absolutely terrifying.
I mean, you say reoccurring dream, like this happened quite a few times.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, like when you work in the front office, you feel like you're part of the team, but it's one thing to feel like you're part of the team, and it's another thing to be out there, you know, seeing a fastball coming at you at 98 miles an hour, you know.
Oh man, yeah, you're right. Well, not that I would know what it working in the front office of a major league organization is like, but they're heavy. Those balls are heavy these days.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. What years did you work?
So I went over there in 2004 when the club was for sale and all the smart people said, you sure you want to go work for a team that's for sale, you know? And I'm like, yeah, man, like if the new owner comes in and they buy it and they clean house, it'll be the coolest 2 months of my life, you know? And so I was there through January, 2012. And then, so I was there for the 2008 and 2011 playoff runs and the Cardinals would always be, you know, there and, it was just rough. And then I went back in 2017 and I was there for 2018, 2019. And then COVID screwed everything up for 2020. So I was there for the golden years, man. It was awesome. And, you know, Council, he's a Marlin too. And, you know, he was there when you guys won the World Series. He's a great guy.
2003.
Yeah.
2003
World
Series.
Hey guys.
There's Lee.
Hey, Lee, how's it going?
You hear me?
Oh yeah.
Perfect.
How's it going, Lee? I froze up. Someone's froze up.
No, you should be good.
Yeah.
We heard you there for a second, Lee, and then you went dead on us.
I swear to God, I don't know if that's Lee Mazzilli or John Travolta. I swear to God it's John Travolta.
That's awesome.
Awesome.
Is he, Andrew?
I got a couple of questions.
Yeah, he's unmuted.
Okay. You guys hear me at all or no?
Now we can.
Oh, yeah.
I can't hear you.
Oh. Oh, yeah. You know, my wife thinks that's a good thing.
I got you.
Me.
All right.
You guys got me now?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Eddie, how are you, my man?
Lee, how you doing?
I'm your number one fan. Do you know that?
No, I had no idea. Tell me more.
Absolutely. When I was watching the Mech game, and all of a sudden I heard about you speed skating, my ears perked up. Then I kind of got into it and read more about you. And now I'm just like, I pull for you all the time, my man. It's just, it's awesome. Oh,
thank you, Lee. That means a lot coming from you.
And I think you played against my son. Because you played in
Canapolis. Yeah.
And you played in Canapolis in 14.
Wait, is your son LJ?
Yeah, yeah.
LJ Mazzilli, LJ. No way.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, man. Yeah. 2000. Yeah, that was around 2014 because I came up to low A at the end of that year.
He was there in
with the Rockies, right? The Rockies?
No, he was with the Mets in Savannah. He was in
Savannah. That's who it was.
And so yeah, I was looking up your, you know, your bio and stuff. And I said,
Yeah, he played in Savannah. So that was the White Sox.
Right. And that was the Canapus Intimidators.
He was with the White Sox this year until the pandemic happened. He signed as a free agent. So now he's a free agent again. So,
yeah. Wow. That's awesome. Where are you guys located now?
We're in Connecticut, in Greenwich, Connecticut. So I'm looking to we're looking to downsize and get to warm weather right now, man. I'm done.
Oh, I heard South Florida has pretty good weather around this year.
Yeah, I'm done, man.
Hey, that's awesome. Lee, I got a question for you.
Yeah.
Throughout your years in baseball, did you ever have to deal with a certain gentleman by the name of Trey Hillman? Jesus.
Love Trey Hillman.
That's Trey quite Hillman. The character. That was my third base coach this year.
Yeah, I know. I was going to say, he's your third base coach. Yeah, him and I managed together in the Yankee system. Oh, going back, I guess in like 97, somewhere around there. And, I know Trey a long time. He's a good man. He's a good baseball man. I'm sure he helped you.
Oh, I mean, the amount of the hours of early work that we did together was a good man. He was the happiest to do it, too.
Yeah, you make sure you tell him I said hi when you speak to him.
Oh, I did.
And Donnie.
Well, he ignored my text message.
Yeah, and Donnie was, Donnie was my teammate. We played together.
Right.
In the Yankees in 82. Yeah. So there's some history there. But Trey.
I'm going to have to. When I see him, I think we have like a hitter's camp in January. If that happens, I should see them then. So I will make sure that we talk trash behind your back.
Wouldn't want it any other way.
Yeah, I know. You're a baseball guy, you know. So.
I know how it goes.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. I'm just going to do a quick test from the Braves room, make sure we can hear them. Apologize for the interruption. They're about to bring folks in.
Okay, I'm going to see if I can. Can you hear the music in the background of my side? No, we're good. Okay.
We're fine. All right.
We're good.
Can you hear us okay?
This is Scott in Atlanta. Hey, Matt, if you could go ahead and switch over to the Zoom call so we can see also. Checking 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Can you guys hear us okay?
Yep.
Yeah.
You hear us and see us?
Yeah.
All right. Well, good, because we'll have people sitting around the room here and asking questions during the Q&A. You ready for us, Scott?
Is Snick going to be there?
Not yet. Not yet.
Is that Lee?
Yeah. Hey, Lee, Mike Plant.
Hey, Mike, how are you?
Great.
Yeah, hey, you know what? It's so great. It just seems so great to where you've been and to where you ended up in baseball and in such a great prominent position with the Braves. It's just, time goes by so quick and we lose track. And then to see what you've done from skating to now, which I wish I would have known earlier, but that's kind of cool. So congratulations on everything.
Thank you, Lee. I was just telling this whole group in our club, I said, I just remember when I was a kid and I got skating, Lee Mazzelli was like a legend. and then to see you, what you did with your career, obviously, I followed it extensively. So, I really appreciate you doing this. Look, we had 40 people show up here. And, I
was good or bad? In the locker room.
That's really good. Really good. Okay. So, and after this, we're gonna go out in the dugout. We're gonna drink some bourbon and some wine, smoke cigars, and so
there you go. That'll work.
So Lee Snit is here, and Bruce Benedict.
Cool! I love that. I want to say hi to Snit and Benedict. Yeah.
So they're both here, and then Greg McMichaels was after you. He was one of our pitchers, but I'm gonna bring everyone in. You guys are good.
Yeah. Okay.
Dave on? Dave Campbell's there.
Yeah, Dave.
Hey man, how are you doing? Okay.
And how about Eddie? Hey,
I'm here.
Eddie, there. I told you 2 years ago you were getting discouraged. I said, stick with it, man. You are putting that uniform on.
All right, Mike. Thank you, man. Yeah.
Right.
Hey, I should have hired Mike as my hitting coach.
Come on in, everyone. Grab a seat. But I'm going to put Stitz and Bruce right here.
Bonnie Blair in the house.
Hey,
Bonnie. Hey, Bon.
What's up, Bonnie Blair?
I think she's trying to figure out the volume and the speaker as well.
Quiet all of a sudden. Hello.
I just muted while everyone was getting settled in there.
Oh, good. I you know, I always get a little nervous when it gets quiet and makes me feel like something important's about to happen. And
just setting the scene.
Got some theme music.
I was thinking before during the test, y'all missed that, but probably better off.
Yeah.
Bonnie, can you hear me?
Yeah, Lee, how are you?
Hey, you know, we haven't seen each other in what, 30 years, maybe?
But you look exactly the same.
That's just lucky from mom and dad, you know, get good genes, that's it.
There you go. Well, that's all you need.
That's good to see you.
Yeah, I was actually trying to find some pictures from when we went to some of your games, but I should have started looking before today. But oh well, if I find them, I'll send them to you in an email.
All right. Sounds good. They didn't have cameras back then. When we played.
Well, and actually from what I remember, the pictures were not very good.
No. So we can lie about what we did then.
Right.
Is Snit there? Is Brian there?
He is.
Can he hear us?
Probably not. We're probably on mute to them right now. I know it would have been fun to have some old photos of Lee on the stage. I haven't seen any of those.
Hey, Bonnie.
Well, and I want to say, I think there was one for sure on the starting line with my brother. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'll have to dig and I'll see if I can find it.
Bonnie, you need to tell Eddie how good I was back then. Oh. He doesn't know.
Hi, Bonnie. How you doing?
Hi, Eddie. I'm good. No, he was really good. Like,
no, I did a little stat check. I know. I know. Yeah. They carry those stats now on the internet. Do? Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah, they don't you can't lie too much.
No.
Yeah, be careful with this internet thing.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. That's awesome. It's good to see you, Bonnie.
Yeah, nice to see you too. And
yeah,
congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Fun watching from afar.
Oh, thank you so much. I wish we could have done this in person this year. Yeah. But yeah, I know it'll happen again.
Hey, Andrew, the clubhouse
something to maybe look forward to in the future.
Exactly. Yeah.
There must be people having troubles getting in since they're all on their phones.
No, everybody's good, and I think we're going to get going here. We seem to be good in Atlanta, and we're good on the Zoom, so we'll get started. For those of you in Atlanta who don't know me, my name is Ted Morris. I'm the executive director at US Speed Skating, one of the greatest jobs in the world. I'm lucky enough to have to work for these amazing athletes. And we got a really special night tonight to explore this weird connection between baseball and speed skating. And first, I just want to thank Mike Plant for putting this together, putting the event together in Atlanta. And a round of applause. Great year for the Braves this year. I'm wearing my
Do I have to give a round of applause?
No, you don't have to clap. Okay. I'm wearing my speed skating sweatshirt, but I do have my Braves shirt on.
I got it on.
He's got his speed skating shirt on. And just to help set the tone, we're going to run a little video that'll share with you the amazing history that US Speed Skating has, tell you a little bit about the organization and who we are. So if we could roll the video.
Passion, dedication, sacrifice, triumph. These are the shared stories of U.S. speed skating legends. Eric Heiden.
Eric Heiden has the lead as he crosses the finish line.
Bonnie Blair.
Bonnie Blair has moved into the lead.
Bonnie Blair is on.
Apollo Ohno.
And Ohno will get the U.S. on the podium with bronze.
Dan Jansen.
Here is Dan Jansen, and he crosses it, and he's in first place.
Their success was not achieved on their own. It was the result of a community. A team supporting their journey as they grew from hometown heroes to Olympic champions.
Johnny Davis pushing it till the end, and he's got another gold medal.
A community of volunteer coaches and officials, parents driving many miles each day to get their kids to practice. And behind the scenes, donors supporting U.S. athletes by helping to provide the services and resources they need to compete against the best in the world.
When sponsors get connected to a sport and or sports through whether it's U.S. Speed Skating, the Olympic Committee, I think they really have this great connection to the athletes, to the sport, that makes them a little bit more invested when the Olympics come on, when there's World Cups, when there's World Championships.
The great thing about being a coach and why I love it is helping athletes achieve their dreams and, you know, maybe getting to a level that maybe they didn't even think that they could attain. So seeing them work hard, you know, and through the process, through the good and the bad times, is really, really rewarding.
U.S. speed skating legends of yesterday continue to inspire the current stars of today.
Without my family, friends, donors, sponsors, staff, I wouldn't be here today. I can't say thank you enough. One of the coolest things that we've done with U.S. Speed Skating is in recent years is have an annual bike ride. And we've got to meet some really great donors and spend some time with the people that are contributing to our federation. And that's a really cool opportunity.
Going to the Olympic Games means a whole lot, like a whole bunch of things to me. So first of all, and most importantly, I get to represent my country, and I'm very, very grateful and so proud to be an American. I also get to represent myself, but also I get to represent the Black community because we, like Black people in general, just like don't get the opportunities that I feel like we should. So being able to go and represent us as a whole community and as like a race is such a cool experience to have, and I really, really hope that I'm able to do it again and again, maybe twice, who knows, but yeah, we'll see about that.
Olympic sport unites the world, entire nations and local communities behind these amazing athletes who have dedicated their lives to the sport they love and the opportunity to represent their countries at the highest level. The USA is the only country in the world where there is no federal funding for Olympic athletes. We rely on sponsors and donors to fund our teams.
What I love most about speed skating is the whole atmosphere we have about it. The people from the club are so nice, and we're all just trying to push each other to be better. Another aspect I really like is the technical aspect and how hard it is. It's the challenge, right?
I like speed skating because I like going fast.
U.S. Speed Skating is committed to providing support to athletes up and down the athletic pipeline. Without high school or collegiate speed skating, we need to focus resources on our own development to be competitive with the best speed skating countries in the world.
When an athlete has to go to their job after training or on a day where it's a recovery day, it definitely can impact performances both in training and then ultimately in competition.
Being able to be affiliated with something with the word Olympic to it, something that happens once every 4 years, there's not much better opportunity and life lessons. Just those experiences coming all together is something that I think is a great part of being part of US speed skating.
Being able to compete in the Olympic Games has been a dream come true, to be able to represent my home state of Florida, my family, friends, and the United States of America is something that you can't even explain.
Brittany Poe!
As the saying goes here in the US, America doesn't send its athletes to the Olympics, Americans do.
We need your help to make Olympic dreams become a reality for our skaters. Join us in becoming part of the team behind the team. You will cheer as U.S. speed skaters cross the finish line.
And Kruger in second!
You will feel the emotion as Olympic champions stand for the national anthem while the American flag is raised behind them. You will be an important part of the community and the family that creates the next generation of U.S. speed skating legends.
Thanks. And with that, we're going to get right into it because this is really going to be a fascinating and fun evening. And I want to introduce our MC and host for the night. He also has a baseball connection. In addition to being a two-time Olympian in speed skating, he also spent 10 years in the front office with the Milwaukee Brewers because he never learned how to hit a curveball. it's my pleasure to introduce Dave Tamburino.
Thanks, Ted. Hey, everybody. It is an absolute honor and a total pleasure to be here with you guys, to be asked to host the conversation between Lee Eddy and everyone else is just an absolute pleasure. And it's an honor. So one of the things I put together is this is your life a little bit. And I promised to keep it to a minute apiece, but figure we kick it off with Lee. I got to tell you, Lee, you're a hometown hero of mine. I've born in Saratoga Springs, New York.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll tell you, in the Saratoga Winter Club, you are an absolute legend, man. I'll tell you, you know. So
grandfather. You had the Worcester family. You had
Johnny. Yeah. Worcester. Oh, yeah. The Worcester boys are just like, they are legendary. Bonnie knows them well. And so here you go. Mr. Lee Mazzilli, born in Brooklyn, New York, the son of a boxer. As a kid, winner of 8 national speed skating championships. 8. You're ambidextrous, right? You're a switch hitter and you throw righty. And we got to remember that because there's another dude in this room that does the same thing. You're a first round draft pick by your hometown team, the New York Mets. We want to pay attention to that because that comes in later too. Your MLB career as a player, 14 seasons for the Mets, Rangers, Yankees, Pirates, Blue Jays. Grandfather praises you. He loves you. He is a lifelong Met fan. MLB All-Star, 1979. My favorite part, scoring the tying and winning runs for the National League in the All-Star game. Huge. Absolutely huge. Two-time World Series champion, 1986 as a player with the Mets, 2000 as first base coach with the New York Yankees. Lee, you're a big league manager. You're a broadcaster, off-Broadway actor, father, husband, household name, my hometown. Lee Lewis Mazzilli, everybody. Just an absolute pleasure.
Thank you.
And round two, here we go. Eddie Alvarez, he's another switch-hitting right-handed player with skating and baseball in your blood. You got to play for your hometown team, too. I mean, I can't even imagine what that's like. I mean, that's got to be unbelievable.
It was a dream, honestly, a dream come true. Just, yeah, I grew up a mile and a half from the stadium.
That's crazy.
Of what is Marlins Park now. I grew up a mile and a half from Orange Bowl Stadium that was then changed to Marlins Park.
Hmm. Well, I heard some people call you Eddie the Jet. I think it's totally appropriate.
Oh, thank you.
You're born in Miami. Parents Mabel and Walter, they immigrated here from Cuba. You have an incredible, incredible story. My favorite part is the plastic roller skates you learned on when you were 5 and showing off tricks down at the beach back in the day. Yeah. And thank God when you were 7, you found the ice, you know. I heard that Jen's coach was your coach, right?
Right.
And
yeah,
that was a huge.
It was no joke by chance that I got steered in the direction of Jennifer Rodriguez's coach.
Oh, yeah. We know Jen. She's an angel.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she did it. You won the Triple Crown, which is unheard of. I don't know who else has won age group nationals for long track, short track, and inline. That's ridiculous. And you did it when you were 11, you know, just a handful of years on the ice. And then, you know, before you know it, you won gold, silver, bronze for the U.S. in the World Cup and at the Junior World Championships. It's insane. You're the first Cuban-American male speed skater to make an Olympic team. You did that in 2014. Yeah. And then that, like, that wasn't enough. You had to go and win a silver medal in the Olympics, which is, you know, I mean, that's royalty to get on the podium, you know. And the Jesus, thing that blows me away, Eddie, 4 months later, you sign a contract with the White Sox. Like, yeah. For real? That's awesome. And in less than 2 years, you tore through the minors. You made it through AAA, and most guys don't even get a look at AAA. But as if that wasn't enough, when you got traded to the Marlins from the Sox, I saw your big league hit. That was awesome. I can't tell you how many people were cheering for you when you got your first big league hit. That was insane. And that was, you know, I told you before we got on the call, I remember seeing your first strokes here at the Pettit when Mike Whitty was working with you and your dad came up from Miami. It's magic, you guys. So, ladies and gentlemen, Eddie Alvarez, here you go.
Thank you, guys. That was Tambo. That was something special, man. You're going to get me choked up over here.
Well, it's the goal.
I have a question for Eddie. Eddie, what's the most important thing to you, the Olympic gold medal or your first major league hit? Tough one, buddy, huh?
Jeez. wow. You know, I'm going to have to say both hold a very special place in my heart. But I'm going to say jumping over the lines, entering, you know, being the home or the visiting team in Baltimore, you know, just jumping over that line on the third base side, just knowing that I made it was probably going to take the cake on all that.
Yeah.
Ironically, you know, the Orioles, you managed that team for a bit,
yes,
right?
I did. Yes. Yeah. Yes. 2004 and 5. And for me, is Snit there? Is Brian
Snit's
there?
Got to be here somewhere.
Can you hear us?
Raise your hand, man.
Can you hear us?
He can hear you. Yeah, I don't know if we can.
Can you raise his hand? Can you raise his hand? Where's he at?
Andrew,
he's out there. He is.
Hey, can you hear me?
2019 Manager of the Year.
Hey, Snit.
Hey.
I have to say something. I just want to say something to you. I'm so happy for you and like proud because I've watched you. I've been in this game a long time and I know you have. And just, you know, winning the manager of the year is great, but you paid your dues and you've been with that organization so long. And to see you pay your dues and come up and achieve the success that you have as a manager, it's just so cool, man. It just makes me feel good knowing that. Here are people that pay their dues. You spent 30 years or so with the organization. And just to see you out there, it's just cool, man. I just want to say it's all congratulations. I'm so happy for you, and you deserve everything you get, man. It's good, really good. I'm pulling for you.
Okay, thanks. I don't know if you can hear me, but thank you, Nate. Because I said I really enjoyed our visit in Yankee Stadium a couple of years ago, and I appreciate you coming in and looking me up, and the visit we had was awesome. Love you, brother. Thank you very much.
Hey, tell Eggs I said hi. It's been a long time.
It's awesome. Hey, real quick, I'm sorry to interrupt. Snit, again, just out of curiosity, Snit, what's my scouting report?
You don't want to know.
What we got?
You know what, Eddie?
Hey, if you don't give it to me, I'll ask Mike. That's no problem.
You know what, Eddie? I don't know if you can. Congratulations on your success, what you've been through. I know how hard this game is to play if you play it all the time. What you've done is spectacular. I applaud you. I can't wait to see you in spring training. I'm going to look you up. We're going to visit.
Appreciate it.
But congratulations,
that's awesome.
On your success, brother. Good for you.
That means a lot. That means a lot. Thank you. Man. Another guy, they make you choke up. Jesus, I need a drink,
hey,
guys.
Don't worry about it. He'll make you choke up, but he's going to get you out. No matter
you know, he's going to throw me all the changes and curveballs. Hey, I know it.
Hey, Brian.
It's all right. Little Lee, the thing is, he doesn't know that I got Sandy Alcantara standing outside the door. Right now.
Hey, Snick, can you hear me? Snick, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
You know, I just want to tell you a quick story. When I was managing Baltimore, and you'll get a kick out of this, why the Braves is just a great organization, because you had great baseball people, you know, John Schulhols and Coxie, and just it reminds me of the Yankees, how they keep their people, you know, forever. And I was managing Baltimore, and I remember a play. We had some interleague play, and Coxie was on the other side, and Tim McCullen made a call at first base, and obviously it was a bad call, and Coxie came out, and he argued the call, and he said that the first baseman, the ball went in his web, and he told the first baseman he bobbled the ball, and then McCullen overchanged the call. So I went out there arguing, and I said to him, there's no way you can bobble a ball when it's in the glove. I said, the only reason why you change the call is because Coxie made you change the call. And he looked at me, and he goes, yep. And he goes, when you have 20 years of managing, I'll change it for you. You're out. And he threw me out of the game. And that was Bobby Cox doing that. I tell you.
That's good.
That's perfect. Fun. I look at that all the time, Lee, when I go out there.
Didn't work. Tambo, you've lost control.
Yeah, I did.
Well, we can go on baseball forever. You know that.
I'll tell you, man, the best part, you let that horse run wild, is when you let go of the reins and that horse goes. Those are the best parts. Absolutely, man. It is absolutely. But let me do this. Let me just get into some basic questions. We're going to have a lot of fun. We're going to get a chance to do some Q&A. And who knows how long or how deep this is going to go. But let me do this. Let me grab the reins a little bit. Lee and Eddie, I'm telling you, man, you guys are both incredible baseball players in your own right. You know, incredible speed skaters, too. You know, I'm going to ask Lee right away, you know, from your perspective, I know it might have been a couple months since you laced up the blades and stuff, but, like, any similarities to those two very different sports that, you know, might explain any of the success that you've had? Because, you know, obviously the boys of summer and baseball is summer, speed skating, very chilly, especially in your era back in the day. There was, you know, I think it was like indoor and outdoor that they call it. It wasn't short track, long track. You know, what is it about? Is there anything, any similarities between the two sports? Because they couldn't seem too different in my mind.
They are too different. And I think the one thing that we have as athletes is that competitive gene. We have something inside us that I can't answer, and I don't know what it is. And Eddie or in the competition of a game, and Bonnie knows, either when you get on the line or when I get in that batter's box, it's mano-a-mano, one-on-one, and we compete and we fight to the end. And we got to fight the fight. And I don't think there's a difference in skating or baseball. It's just you're competing for a reason, is to win. It doesn't happen all the time. But that's the similarities I see in that. I don't, you know, from the actual physical part of it, no, not really. I guess for me, for running, because I always could run and sprinting was my thing, I guess that helped. But I guess it's just the competition more than anything for me anyway. It just, like, even now at my age now, and I know that I can't do it, but I think right now that I feel like if I went up, if there was a man on second base, that I can get him in. Like, I think I can knock him. I know I can't, but I believe that. And I never want to lose that competitive edge that we have as athletes. Because once we lose it, we just turn the clock off and it's over. So I still feel like that I can go up there and hit. I know I can't, but I think I can. And that's a good thing to have. And we should never lose that trait that we all have.
You know, and I think back in the day when I was racing, you know, when I got up on the line, it didn't matter if it was a heat semifinal. And I think back to the words of the great Ted Kozinski, if you can't beat him in the heat, then you can't beat him in the final. You know, like, who is that pitcher, right? Who is that pitcher that when you lined up, you know, you're looking down.
Man, there was so
and who and who was that skater? Was it Robbie Blair? But who was it that,
you know, you looked at and you're like, okay, man, it's on. So who's that big pitcher and who's that big skater?
I mean, there's so, I don't know if there's one. There's so many of them. I mean, you had guys like Nolan Ryan. I mean, that was a battle in itself. Tom Seaver, guys like that. You know, from the skating standpoint, it was, I don't know, Bonnie Blair can answer this because during the skating, Bonnie, I didn't lose a lot, right? So I felt like, you know, I had that attitude where no one was going to beat me anyway. But I was short track, you know, as opposed to long track. That's just the attitude. I'm not saying it was. You know, obviously you do lose, but I don't know, Bonnie. You can answer that. I just
From what I remember, I was little, but I definitely remember, and it's weird that, you know, it kind of brings like another link of another sport together, but I remember nationals in St. Louis. Mm-hmm. And I think the other thing too, it was kind of like one of those times, like the Land of Lincoln, where I grew up in Champaign, was a big meet that drew people from all over the country. There were certain competitions that drew others. So like when Lee came from out, you know, like they knew, oh God, here comes Lee Mazzilli. You know, that was a threat for, I think, the other athletes. Probably like, you know, the Barcheskis. I think that's probably a name. And I was even trying to think, maybe Billy Anderson was one.
Yes, that's a good name.
I was trying to think of some names of guys that were, you know, my brother was good, but he only for like the really short races. So probably off the line, he might have beat Lee, but at the end, Lee's going to beat Robbie. So, you know, but I think that was it. It was like there were certain competitions during the year that drew everybody from the United States. So like, like I said, the Land of Lincoln was one. You know, obviously Nationals was another one, you know, where skaters from California came and, you know, the eyes of the athletes, I think, really opened up. But I really remember Nationals in St. Louis where they played it, or they skated at the, where the Blues played.
Right.
And then the Blues had a game right afterwards, but it was like, they played the organ, and as the race got, I don't know whether as the race got faster, the organ got faster, or vice versa, but it made for unbelievable fun races to watch. Yeah. That's really what I remember of Lee.
And it was a little, the difference was in short track, it was like four cones, Eddie, that they had on each corner. So I was like one of the first with, you know, how you would drag your hand back then at the time. And then we'd have outdoor meets in Minnesota too, as well. Now, I remember going to St. Paul, Minnesota, where it was 52 below zero when we were skating. That's doing the outdoor track. And it was just 52 below and he had tights on. Like, we were nuts, man. But it was fun times. And then my favorite was short track, like you. I enjoyed that very much. But when I was skating for the Olympics, they didn't have that. And that event wasn't in. It was just long track. And so it was different. I wish that I had that opportunity. I think if there's one thing, someone asked me this question, one thing I regret during my professional career was, I really wish I had a chance to go to the Olympics and be part of an Olympic team for the United States. And it's great that you can, Eddie and Bonnie, but when I qualified for, I think it was for the junior national team, I'm not sure. And you had to go to Colorado in the Air Force Academy. You had to train for 2 months. And this was like in 1971 for the 72 Sapporo Japan Games. And that's when I was getting drafted and scouts were watching me. So I could not leave in the middle of the summertime. So it was a decision I had to make. It's either skating or baseball at that time, because you weren't allowed, as you are now, to be a professional and be an amateur. Back then, you could not be a professional and go to the Olympics. So that obviously that's changed now. And I couldn't do that. So I picked baseball. But I wish I could have represented our country. I think that's so neat, man, to be on the Olympic team. I really do.
So building on that, Lee, Eddie, you know, talk about, like, you've had the opportunity to not only build upon, not only to represent your country in the Olympics, but also represent your hometown, you know, of Miami on the diamond. Talk a little bit about, you know, what that feeling was like, and, you know, it's hard to weigh one against the other, but you did it, man.
It was a long winding road for sure. But I want to piggyback a little bit off what Lee was saying. You know, you're right. Maybe the course of life itself and decision makings that you've had to make, Lee, didn't give you the opportunities to, you know, represent the country and Olympic team and stuff like that. But we all know that you are more than deserving for that title. And you are no joke, the epitome of an optimistic mindset and a go-getter, because I mean, the career you have built and that decision making, which is something that I battled a lot with my life and jumping from sport to sport, that's one that I couldn't, one I was always scared of, but never, I guess I never crossed paths like yours did. You were then and there, you knew you had to give up skating to chase a baseball career, and you've made a beautiful career out of it, and one that I could only ever hope for. So I applaud you for that. Thank you for, you know, paving the way for guys like me. 'Cause that's something that I've always had to battle, was jumping between sports, growing up in Miami, Florida. You don't really find ice around here much, but you did find wheels. And you know, on the weekends in the '90s, it was like the cool thing to do. It's, you know, you go to South Beach, put on your spandex, your tights, a bandana, you bump the cassette player, you go and check out some girls in bikinis. I'm sorry, Bonnie, that you have to listen to me say that. But that's how it all started. Just to be able to carry that journey, jumping back and forth between sports, and to be able to have the opportunity to represent my culture, not only that, but, you know, the United States of America, the land that has given my family opportunity. It was an absolute honor. And we're here now. We're here.
Eddie, only thing is, I came from Brooklyn, New York, so I didn't tell anyone I wore tights when I was skating.
You'd get beat up. You came from the era of the, you know, the true Bronx, boxing Bronx. Yeah, you know, you had to fight your way, you know, for status. No, I know. My dad's a boxing manager at the moment, and he's done his fair share of New York throughout the eras. Fair share of New York fights, and he's told me all a bunch of stories and stuff, so I can only imagine.
Good.
You're a hard-nosed guy.
Well, unfortunately, during this pandemic, New York is in really a bad shape right now, so we're kind of all hoping that things change around, but it's not a pretty sight right now. It really isn't.
So, just real quick, you know, like, I get it. My dad is from Corona, Queens in New York, and he tells me about, you know, the stories of being there back in the day. And, you know, Lee, growing up in New York, what were some of the tough challenges that you had to deal with, you know, as a kid growing up in New York? And
great question. It's kind of like it is now. It's getting like, it's, you know, when I came up to the big leagues in the 70s, in 1976, I came up, you know, New York was in a bad state. It was really bad. It was broke. It was going bankrupt. There was strikes in the city. Crime. It was just a terrible, terrible time. And when I was playing in Sandlot Ball, you know, my school was condemned by the city. You couldn't play on the grounds because it was so bad. It just wasn't a very good time in New York during the 70s. And, you know, it's funny because if you look back as a baseball person, back then, you know, George Steinbrenner kind of put baseball back on the map in New York in the 70s when he came in and took over ownership. And baseball was really on a decline here. And, you know, with the Yankees and their success and with him, he put baseball back on the map. I believe that. I really do in New York. And then things started to get, you know, better.
Yeah. Eddie, what was it like growing up in Miami? You know, you had a chance to, you know, be a Miami guy.
Right. Well, I mean, I'm in Miami, which is a mecca for baseball. So not very often you're going to find a Cuban-American kid to put on willingly, put on tights and go out somewhere in the Midwest and skate on ice. It was an unbelievable journey. And like, and again, I'm going to piggyback a little bit on what Lee was saying about the competitive spirit that, you know, the sport of speed skating builds. I think, and, you know, I've spoken to Ted a little bit about this, and, you know, if it wasn't for everything that I've had to overcome, the opportunities that I've had to create for myself, through hard work, if it wasn't for US speed skating, if it wasn't for the organization, man, I probably wouldn't say that I'm an Olympic athlete, nor be in the position to say that I'm a major leaguer as well. So
yeah. Well, you were at a crossroads at some point with your skating career, right? Where you had to decide, like many of us, you know, we, you know, in the spirit of Eric Clapton, you get to the crossroads, right? And you choose what you do, you know, and you were at a crossroads, Eddie, at some point where you had to decide, am I going to continue with this? Am I going to, and talk a little bit about the impact that the support you had from US speed skating, you know, to help you achieve, you know, Olympic glory. Cause like you've had the opportunity and you achieved it, you know, to be on that podium, and not many people know what it's like to be on the podium at the Olympic Games. And, you know, talk about that support and the, you know, what helped get you to that point,
right?
And the feeling of being, what was it like to be on the podium at the Olympics?
All right. So touching back to one of your first questions, it was, I started seeing like where my decision-making was getting a lot more difficult around high school, where my high school coach was kind of not supportive of the fact of me doing two sports. That was like my first decision that I was content with letting go of speed skating for the rest of my life and concentrating on baseball. But he was kind of on to something, because I turned around my high school career. I had, you know, a couple offers to some good to some good programs. I signed a full ride scholarship to a school my brother went to that got drafted out of
St. Thomas.
St. Thomas University out here, a little outside of Miami. But it was more of the coach that I was chasing. And that, if it wasn't for that coach, Manny Mantrana now, who's unfortunately battling cancer, if it wasn't for him, I don't think I would have been where I am now, saying that I'm an Olympic athlete and an Olympic silver medalist, because he was the one that when I walked into the office and said that there's something in the back of my mind and I don't know how to get it off my chest. He asked me what it was. I told him, I want to try and be an Olympic speed skater. This is something that just been egging on the back of my head. And he motivated me to just go. And he said that whenever I decide to come back, that he'll have that scholarship ready for me. So it gave me motive to just be okay leaving baseball and chasing a dream that ended up being 6 years later that I, you know, accomplished. But yeah, I mean, through thick and thin, US speed skating has been nothing but supportive in my career. I mean, when I decided to stop after I didn't make the Vancouver Games in 2010, I decided to take a year off, go to school, and play baseball there at Salt Lake Community College while still living in the same, town home with my roommate, Brittany Bowe, who was, in the video previously. I was training in the mornings, with the U.S. national team, going to class, training baseball in the afternoon, and then going to night class so I can finish my credits so I can be a full-time student to play. And it was struggling, but U.S. speed skating was always there. And they, you know, through my young adult years, have allowed me to develop into the athlete I am today. And they just always surrounded me with unbelievable staff and mentors. So
yeah, I got to tell you, man. Like I know I never swung a bat on a major league ball field. One thing that you know, good mentor of mine at the Brewers always told me is baseball. It's a marathon. It's not a sprint. You know, it's a grind. You know, if we can get a chance for Lee and Bonnie, maybe even Snit, if you can do it, if you can give a little bit of advice to Eddie, right? And specifically for you, Lee, you know, talking to Eddie as if, you know, because he's the same son as same age as your son. If like Lee and Bonnie and Snit can give a little bit of advice, and Snit, I know like Eddie's on, you know, he's on a different team, but like, you know, we're pulling for him. You know, what can we say to Eddie? You know, like Lee, if Eddie was your son, if like, what advice have you given to your son that you could give to Eddie to keep him pounding, man? Because like I said, it's a marathon. It's not a sprint. And you gotta just keep hammering, man.
You know, it's a good question. I've been asked that question so many times. People ask that. And the only advice that you can give someone, and it was like my own son, who's still playing and chasing his dream. And I know he's got a chance, but that's up to him. But you gotta really, my dad told me this all the time. He said, you gotta have fun. You gotta have fun. You know, I said this earlier in the broadcast, we have something inside us that the average mortal outside the games of baseball and athletes just don't have. We have something in it, in us. And there's a competition. There's a love for the game. When you stop loving what you're doing and you think it's a job, then it's time to get out. When you feel like it's a grind to get up at 5 a.m. in the morning to do your workouts, it's time to get out. Because, you know, they say that the only time success comes before work is in a dictionary, right? So you need to work. You need to do this. I've always had fun doing it. I knew what I had to do. I knew when I wasn't good enough or whatever. We fail. We can't be afraid to fail. You know, Joe Torre always told me that, and I learned that as a player, and I learned it as a manager, to don't be afraid to take a risk. We, you know, Snit could say that too as a manager. Hey, we're okay taking a risk and making a move, and if it doesn't work out, that's all right. We'll answer to that. But if we're afraid to take a risk in our careers, we're never going to reach the top, because we have to fail, man. We have to, you know. I look at the Braves this year, man, they had a hell of a year. Are you kidding me? They're at the prep. They were right there going to the series. So they lost. They're defeated. They're hurt. They're down. I get it. I've been there. I lost the World Series. But that doesn't stop me from being ready for next season and going at it. I bet you those guys are doing their work right now. It's just part of life, man. You know, if you give everything you have, and I left it all on the field, and if Bonnie was racing, I left it out there, and they beat us, or someone, or a team, just maybe they were better than us today. Just today. Doesn't mean they're going to do it tomorrow. They beat us today. I can live with that. But I can't live with not being prepared for what I want to do and then get beat. That I can't live with. That I have a hard time living with, you know. It's okay to get beat. There's some people are better than other people. Some teams are better than other teams. But if you're not ready to compete and then you lose, you're the one that has to put your head on the pillow that night knowing that you didn't give what you had. And that's a bad feeling to have. Bad feeling.
Well, you are 100% correct. I can say this and testify to this, that one thing that has driven my career was the fear of regret. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, jumping from sport to sport, although it was a scary decision, it was like, I knew that when I grow older, if I look back and I regretted something, that I was not going to be content with that. So amen to that.
Yeah. I mean, let's just say, God forbid, you never played another day in the big leagues, or next year you never play baseball again. Just think what you can go when you have a family and grandkids and tell them what you accomplished. Just think about that. I was on the U.S. Olympic team. I played Major League Baseball. Well, how long did you play? I only played for a little bit. But who cares? Look what you accomplished. That's how you look at success, you know. And if we don't look at it monetarily speaking, and unfortunately, that plays a role with some players. But, you know, there's nothing worse in this life than having self-guilt about what you didn't do. Because no one beats themselves up more than us. You know, no one. You can't say anything that's going to make me feel bad. I already know I made an error. What are you going to do? You going to tell me I made an error? I already knew I struck out with the bases loaded. I know that. I can't feel any worse. You're not going to make me feel any worse. So that self-guilt is bad, but it just keeps you fighting, man. You got to fight the fight. You got to fight the fight. That's it.
Lee, you've had enormous perspective, man. You've been there as a manager. You've been there as a first base coach. You've been there as an athlete. You know, you have perspective that most of us, you know, will never have, you know, and you know, when you see talent, you know, talent, you know, and you look at guys like Eddie and Eddie, you know, when you look in your, you know, when you look forward into the future, you know, Eddie, what are you thinking? What's your big one? You know, like, what's your ultimate? Cause you've achieved the ultimate, you know, like for some of us, you know, being on the podium in Olympic Games is, you know, we strove for it. I did not achieve that. It was in the back of my mind. I always wanted it, but you know, you did it as an Olympic athlete and you did it in speed skating. And now you're in the baseball world. You know, what is it for you? You know, what is your ultimate now? And, you know, what do you see in the next, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years as a baseball player?
Right. Honestly, the biggest thing, I hope you guys can hear me. I had to take my AirPods out. They're going to die. Biggest thing is setting an example. I just had a baby 3 months ago. He turns 3 months tomorrow. And thank you guys. And it's honestly, it's changed my perspective so much on life itself. And I just want to, you know, show him that it's okay to chase dreams. Because I'm a true testament to how things shouldn't happen the way they did, and they did. And that's purely through, you know, grit and hard work. And, you know, creating those opportunities for yourself. So, you know, setting the example comes as number one, because, you know, yes, I have a son that I would die for in an instant, but, you know, I know there's more kids out there like me, that, you know, just need a little bit of that push, a little bit of that motivation. And in the future,
you're a parent.
Right. Exactly.
You're a parent now. And one thing I've been dying to ask, like, both you and Lee during this conversation is, you know, I think back to, you know, my mom and dad, Joe and Kathy Tamburino, they had an enormous influence on my life. You know, we all think back to our mom and dad. And so one of the things I've been dying to ask both Lee and you, Eddie, is, you know, and I'll never forget it. You know, Eddie, I remember when you came up to the Pettit and you were taking your first strokes on the ice on long track. And I was there, I was coaching, and I saw you and I said, you know what? That dude's got the feel. He's got the same feel that Kip Carpenter has. He has the same feel. Like, when you see a kid on the ice, you know that they got the feel, right? You could see it. Yeah, and it's the easiest way. And the same thing is with a swing. My son plays baseball. When I see him swing the bat, I'm like, when I see him throw, he's got the feel. Like, you know, when you take a look at it, you know, what do you want? You know, what is it? What's that thing that you can do for your son? And what's it like being a parent? And what advice would you give your son to be out there?
Yeah, Ed. Yeah. Is it Eddie or me?
Is that me or?
You know, it could be Eddie. It could be Eddie.
Yeah,
Eddie. It could be me. I mean, to me is it's, if you're going to do something, do it with passion and do it fearlessly. Like I said before, like my entire entire athletic career was driven by fear of regret. I want my son to just understand that if he needs to look back at something he did in his life and regret not doing it, or if that question still lingers, that what if, then he did something wrong. And I just want to pass that kind of along to him so that he can live a happy and full life. And that's good. And the other question that you had mentioned was like, what do I see myself in the future? And, you know, being, you know, in the world of a sport that is so behind closed doors, because in reality, the public only sees an Olympic athlete every 4 years. After that, you know, after that biggest stage in the world, known worldwide, which is the Olympics, I mean, we go into behind the curtain, right? We get behind the curtain, but we don't really see what happens in those 3 to 4 years of that cycle of the grind that, you know, for example, a US speed skater has to go through. You know, it's 6 to 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, 11 months of the year training days with a 5.5 month season, you know, roughly in a short track world. I can't tell you the number precisely in the long track world, but you got probably 8 competitions a year in the short track world. So the public doesn't really get to see us. So I want to share the stories of athletes. You know, I, you know, was blessed with the opportunity to play a mainstream sport that I could potentially share the stories of so many struggles to get to. And because at the end of the day, we do speed skaters. I know this for a fact because, you know, I lived it. I did this for glory, not for the money, not for, you know, it was more for the title of being able to say that I am an Olympian.
You know, the question is why did you do it? Why did you get up at 5 a.m. and train for 6, 8, 10 hours and compete? Why?
Well, at the time, it was like,
it's a simple, you know,
what I knew I wanted to do. Well, Lee, I mean, you can relate to this.
I look at it very simple.
You can relate to this. I mean, yeah. Bonnie can relate to this. A lot of people can relate to this. If you want something as bad as you want it, you're willing to do whatever the hell.
But there's a reason why. There's a reason why we do it. And it's very simple, is because we love doing it. We actually love doing it. You know, we like being out spring training 5 hours or whatever we're doing, taking BP, because we love doing it. That's what we love to do. You love to skate. Bonnie loves to skate. Once we lose that, we'll never reach the pinnacle. We just don't. Right. We just don't. And. You know, there's that movie For the Love of the Game, and that's what it is, man. We have that, man. We enjoy it, but we like to give back, and we like to teach, and we like to do all those things. And I could ask Brian this question right now. He'll tell you. Where is Brian?
He's there.
Brian, you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you.
Now, we're talking about loving the game, and the question is, we do it because we love it. You tell me why you were managing and doing all the minor leagues for 30 years. You weren't doing it for the money. I know that, right?
Right. You know, Lee, I was balancing my checkbook to go to Kroger every day.
I'm telling you, I know. So what I'm saying is you did it because you loved it, man. You had a passion and a love to teach those kids, and you did it for so long.
We're comfortably miserable in this sport too. Isn't that
Amen to that.
Yeah, but you know what? You could, but now you're enjoying and you're reaping the benefits of it, which you deserve richly. But all the years that you spent in the minor leagues, and even me being all the years that I spent in the big leagues, then I went back to the minor leagues when I had 3 kids at home. You know, taking 12-hour bus trips, I'm saying, what am I doing? I need to be retired. But I loved it. I wanted to manage, and I went back to the minor leagues for 3 years to manage, because we love what we do. it's just simple. If we didn't love what we do, trust me, we wouldn't be there. We just wouldn't be there.
No, Lee, we love it. We do. We what we do. It's who we are. I don't know. You know, it's one of those things where when you're not rolling over in bed at night, worrying about, because like I say, when you're managing, you're coaching, you're worrying more about the players than probably they're worrying about themselves.
Exactly.
And it's the same thing, keep us going, you know, because we do. Like, just like you said, everything you said, we love it. It's everything Eddie's been through. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Now, I can't wait to see Eddie in spring training because I'm going to give him a big hug. Because this kid, everything he's been through, what he's done, God, I you know, and I knew his story when we played him, but it's, you know, it's even more amplified now. But we did. It's something we love to do.
Yep. Eddie, I just want to tell you one thing. He's going to give you a big hug, and then he's going to knock you down the next pitch.
That's why you got to hit over the fence when you get the opportunity. So you can't do that. No more changeups.
That's right. You can't do that anymore.
Hey, Mike, do we have other people there in the clubhouse want to ask some questions of Eddie and Lee?
I think everyone here is ready for a cocktail.
Cheers.
Our glasses are empty.
So I thought it was a cocktail party. Aren't we supposed to be drinking as we're listening?
Hey, real quick, there is something that Lee was talking about, similarities and things like that, and there's something he left out. And something that's very crucial to both sports, and it is probably the one and only thing that is real similar. That if, you know, you don't accomplish the certain task, you know, you're going to fail miserably in both sports. Something that I hold very valuable, as well as Lee should hold valuable, because he understood this the most. And that one thing is you got to turn left.
You can't always turn right. In both sports.
You turn right. In baseball, you turn right, you're going to the dugout. Right turn.
Hey,
you got the boards right there. You can't do that.
I'll tell you what, I made more right turns than I did left turns. That I can tell you.
You kept bunting the ball, Lee.
That's a good point. I like that. That was a good one.
Oh, man.
Well, thanks. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Lee. Amazing. So great to get you back connected with the speed skating world. On everybody's face.
You know, the one thing I was thinking about, if I can just say this real quick, and Bonnie would appreciate that. This, you know, skating has been such a big part of the Olympics, and speed skating wins like 40% of the Olympic winter medals every Olympics. I mean, so we need to promote it, get people out there. I try to tell people that when I skated a little before Eric Heiden did. So I'm a little older than him. And I tell people.
Just a little bit.
Just a little bit. But he never beat me. Nah, it's good. But you know, what Eric Heiden did, to put in perspective, it's mind boggling. So if I took a track and field runner, and if I won the 100 yard dash and won the half mile and a mile and three and a 1500, and then went out and ran the marathon and won the marathon and a gold medal, it's just like one of the greatest sports feats of all times. And it's like he should be in like Jim Thorpe territory. And I really believe that, because people just overlook what he accomplished in that. Was that 1980 Olympics? It's just, it was one of the greatest sports feats of all time. So that's kind of cool. I just want people to know what he was and a big part of skating. And I thank you all. And Snit, I'm going to see you somewhere along the line, my man. And I am pulling for you. I just want to let you know, you are one of my favorites, man.
I got one question for the both of them. To Lee, this actually came from my sister, Angela, because you guys used to be pen pals.
We used to date when we were 14 years old.
Yeah, she wanted to know if you ever had the opportunity to get your kids on ice. And then that turns to Eddie. The question is, Are you going to do ice, baseball, or is it going to be downhill skiing?
Oh, man. Go ahead, Lee. You can answer.
Well, no, for me, no. My kids wanted no part of it. So,
yeah,
I have to get up early in the morning and take them. They were, you know, my son, before while he was playing baseball, played hockey 1 year, and it took me like, I don't know, like an hour and a half to dress him. And I said, I had enough of this, you know, 4:30, you know, in the practice. I said, ah, time out. Ah, I'm excited. And then, no, then after that.
Bonnie, honestly, for me, to be brutally honest, if my mother would have allowed me to play hockey, my life probably would have been a lot easier because it's mixing both sports together. But I would love to get him on skates at an early age, because if there's one thing that I owe a lot of my agility and balance is those damn skates. It's so true. Like my body.
I think either that, and another thing that's good for kids, I think at a young age, is gymnastics, because they really coordination and balance.
Incredible. Yeah. My mother put me in gymnastics for a little bit too, but then I just wanted to run out of there. But yeah, I will introduce him to skates, but at the end of the day, my parents, being from Cuba, never thought I was going to be an Olympic speed skater. So I'm going to let his course and his career take off wherever it may. I just want him to always understand that I'm going to be 100% behind him and support him.
Well, for the record, Eddie's son's name is Jet. So Jet Alvarez better be a speed skater. That's all I'm saying. But thank you, Eddie. Appreciate you being here. And in Atlanta, thank you guys so much for listening to our story, listening to these stories, and also and helping us. And Mike, thank you for leading that charge. And let's commit to doing this again all together in Atlanta next November 19th. Does that sound good?
And Atlanta has the World Series championship.
When they have the trophy. Yeah.
He likes that. Let's go. Oh.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye. Thanks, bye, Eddie. Good luck.
Thanks, guys. Lee.
Stay healthy.
Everyone in Atlanta, thank you, guys. I appreciate it. This was a lot of fun, man. Thanks for letting us share our stories, really.
Yep.
I learned a lot, too. So thanks for the advice and all the support. I've always really felt it. So thank you, guys.
Stay healthy.
Yeah, everyone. All right. Bye, guys.
Bye.
My question is, how do these players sit like this to watch the TV? Did you get Mike to buy them?
They're all
like
right here. They're all around here.
So real quick. So we're gonna go.